About 13.8 billion years ago, the universe began as a tiny, dense fireball that exploded. This moment, coined as the Big Bang, is a marquee chapter in the story of the beginning of everything. But until the 20th century, the chapter was lost in the cosmos. Until one fateful day in 1964, when scientists accidentally stumbled upon a relic of the universe that guided them through space and time to the origins of the Big Bang. You're watching the second episode of Sci-Fi, The Beginning of Everything. Hi, so this is the editing version of me. I have been having a lot of problems with After Effects for the past 200 years now, and with the very super effective community of After Effects. There's no intro in today's video. There's no graphics in today's video. So instead, I'll just pop in every now and then with the green screen. Very charming. Anyway, let's get on with the video. The story about the discovery of the Big Bang is as much a story about a universe as it is about modern science. But before we dive into this, we need to talk about space. Now, what if I told you that for a brief moment in time, the space was actually orange? And to prove that, I'm going to take you to a place where all the answers of the universe exist. My kitchen, obviously. But more specifically, my toaster. Now, if you start a toaster, you will see this red light coming from inside of it. But this doesn't really have a light source. So it's actually coming from the heat of the particles. If you ever happen to have better sensors than just our eyes, we would see that this is actually electromagnetic radiation. And if you ever happen to plot them, you would see something like this. Now, this is called the thermal spectrum of the toaster, and anybody that ever has a temperature will have this thermal spectrum. Fuck. But what does this toaster pale red have to do with the universe? Well, for that, we need to actually travel back in time to about 400,000 years after the Big Bang. So, now, the universe at this point was in a very hot, dense plasma state. And now, as we have established, hot bodies emit radiations. But at this point, the temperatures were so high that nothing could be formed in the universe. Now, as time went by and this ever-expanding universe cooled down, these electromagnetic radiations were free to travel and fill up all of space. And the most fascinating part about it is that billions of years later, these radiations still exist. Now, as time went by and the universe kept expanding, these radiations went through a phenomenon called cosmological redshift. So, they started off as orange, went to toaster red, then infrared, and then eventually to microwaves. And since microwave is outside the visual spectrum, we observe the space as pitch black, even though it is filled with these radiations. But we can still observe them. Now, if you ever happen to point an analog satellite into space, there's a highly likely chance that all you could see is static. But if you happen to observe them a bit more closely, you will see that the static is actually made up of these microwaves. I wonder what happens if we plot these microwaves. Looks familiar? I know. This is very heavy. Okay. Oh, good God. However, until the 20th century, we were not aware about any of this. In fact, Big Bang was just a mere concept. But then in 1964, two scientists in New Jersey, New York, made an accidental discovery that didn't just become the centerpiece in the study of cosmology, but also earned them a Nobel Prize.
This is the satellite, a huge empty balloon.
It was the 1960s. NASA had just launched a novel communication satellite program called the Echo. It was the first attempt at sending communication signals through space, and one of its ground stations was here at Bell Labs in Homedale, New Jersey. The station boasted of a state-of-the-art horn antenna, and radio astronomers Arno Penzias and Robert Wilson were performing experiments and measurement tests with this antenna. And while the measurement setup was state-of-the-art for the time, they noticed this persistent noise in their signal readings.
Well, Arno and I set out to make the best measuring system we could to go with this antenna. We got it all together and fired it up and found more noise coming out of the antenna than we expected.
Now, while noise in real-world data is quite standard, to be honest, this was different. It was a lot more persistent.
We did a few other measurements and we're really scratching our head. We believed in physics. What's coming out has to be coming from somewhere.
And Robert and Arno tried everything, from rejigging the setup, from doing all the calculations all over again, to chasing after pigeons. But the noise was still there. At one point, they thought maybe it was New York City. But eventually, they were tipped off to contact another scientist, Robert Dickey.
Bob Dickey was a very good physicist. He was thinking about an oscillating universe where you have a big bang and then a big crunch.
And when Robert Dickey looked at the readings from the horn antenna, he knew very quickly that this noise wasn't just New York City, but the entire universe from billions of years ago.
Their discovery confirmed the Big Bang theory of the explosive origins of the universe.
Now, deservedly, Robert Wilson and Arno Penzias received Nobel Prizes in 1978 for their contribution and the discovery of the cosmic microwave background. But what is more fascinating for me is how this story about a supposedly failed experiment led us to the depths of how a universe originated. It's a part of a trend, it's a part of a long list of stories which showcase how modern science is built on failures.
As we speak, we are getting closer to the edge of the universe with the help of instruments like the James Webb Telescope. So, what's next in the chapter of the story of the beginning of everything? Well, I don't quite know that yet. But I just hope that whatever it is, I'm around to see it. Thank you for watching this episode of Sci-Fi, and I'll see you in the next one.
Also, just a quick note, the universe doesn't really look like this. It actually looks like this. But it's not that aesthetic, so, you know, aesthetic over science. Okay.